so people can see the screen better with this set of lights off?
With the lights off?
Just the front one.
If you're doing videos.
If you're doing this, if you're doing that, it's better for the
camera.
You're using the camera to shoot.
Yeah, better. It's better with the lights on.
Never
doesn't
mind.
Matter.
Never mind then.
You gotta shut it off if you want to show a video.
Look like Amber if you want.
No, this one. Turn this one off. Turn that one on.
Yeah. Wow, that's, see how nice that is?
That's beautiful. It's good enough.
How's that? How's your camera?
It's okay.
Yeah. I could hold a spotlight.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
Okay.
Good evening. Everybody with me?
Yes.
Hi. Sarvesh.
Yes.
My name is Sarvesh. And in India, when we start with Namaste. So, Namaste.
Namaste.
Before starting, I want you to get into my rhythm, and I want to tell you why I am eligible to do this presentation and why I would do. I started with my medical college in 1999 in India, and after about 6.5 years in medical college, started with my practice and started assisting 2 doctors in India, and flourished well for 2 years. The area of my therapeutics was Western medication in primary, but I was also interested in alternative medication, primarily homeopathy. How many of you have heard of it? How many? Okay, so me too. Okay. So slowly and steadily, as I built up on my practice, the people who came in for the appointments belonged to one major category of diseases. And those diseases were lifestyle diseases. The diseases which had no cause. And for the initial years of my practice, whosoever is seeing this video right now, whom I treated somewhere down that lane, I am sorry, because I was brutal to them. I was brutal because, just like everybody else in the medical college, I thought being in lifestyle diseases, being obese, being diabetic, being hypertensive, being into diabetic gangrene is all their fault, because they did not take care of themselves. They were the one who made wrong choices. They were the one who let themselves fly into their own cravings and succumbed to those cravings. How many of you agree with me? Lifestyle diseases are our own choices. How many of you agree? So, all of you believe that lifestyle diseases happen because of our own choices. After 9 years or 10 years of my practice today, I disagree. This is a myth. People who are responsible for this, they want you to know that you did this to you, because they do not want to be responsible for that. They are into a denial mode, even after knowing that they are the one who did it. So that is why the topic here is, everybody had that brochure, I think, that lifestyle diseases are on a toll now, but who is responsible? I believe it's not you. Now, why that change happened? Because when I passed through my medical college, that's what my teacher told me, that's what my professor told me, that somebody who is on a bad lifestyle is going to get a lifestyle disease for sure. At the age of 24, I was into the final year of my college, doing pretty well. I was an athlete, and suddenly, on a very random day, it was a day when we were having just fun, and somebody just checked my blood pressure. Guy 5 feet 9 inches, 60 kgs in weight. Right now I'm 85. 60 kgs in weight, and blood pressure was 142/96. Oh. I was like, I didn't do that. I never did that. Because I was very conscious of my diet. I was an athlete, and I was a strength training athlete. A middle class, middleweight bodybuilder. How can I have this condition? Not possible. Well, time went by, few changes here and there. I forgot that day. I was on some medications for about 6 months. And then those medications were slowly withdrawn. Until that I'm not on my medication, even after adding 25 kgs.
Can you please be there? Thank you.
He's too young to know all this.
Later.
Yeah. So, another incident happened in 2006. I was into first year of my medical practice. A patient came to me. She had a diabetic gangrene. How many of you are familiar with this term? Diabetic gangrene. You're familiar. Is there a cure to it? Is there a cure to diabetic gangrene? Well,
you have to kill the bacteria.
She was on 6 antibiotics for 9 months. And active infection was not going away. And this is what is the fate of about 46% cases in diabetic gangrene. And then doctor advises amputation, because otherwise it's going to keep moving up, and the part that needs to be amputated just keeps getting large. Nobody wants that. It's always better to cut off a thumb rather than cut off a foot. And always better to cut off a foot rather than cut down a leg. It's always better to cut down a leg rather than cut down a limb. This is medical science. But then, she went to her doctor. Her doctor was my teacher. And after 9 months, he said, I'm referring you to surgeon because antibiotics are not working. Well, when he gave that advice, I was assisting him in his clinic, and I don't know what happened. When she moved out of the clinic, I followed her and I told her that, see, the surgeon that you have been referred to is in USA for 1 week. You are not going to get it amputated for next 1 week. No chance. You have to wait. So why not take a chance? I have read about a certain kind of diet. My knowledge says that it should work. I cannot prescribe it, but I can suggest it. And I will give you some of the natural stuff. So my area of interest was homeopathy, so I gave her some homeopathic medication. And then every patient in that stage is full of fear and curiosity. She said, what should I expect? I said, nothing. You can't expect anything. Because as far as my knowledge is concerned, this is not curable. We are just trying till your surgeon comes back. Okay. So she was on this medication and this special diet. And she was, by that time, she was also on about 17 to 18 pills a day, including insulin, including metformin, including statins and aspirins and whatnot. So after 1 week, the surgeon came back. She had an appointment with him. He examined her, tried to get the pus out of the thumb. He kept pressing. Nothing came out. Surgeon said, wow, after 9 months, antibiotics start working. I could not laugh because I was there and he was like, so, but, well, the smile that I got from that lady that day changed this, changed my profession. And I was more curious about lifestyle diseases. And if they can be managed through small changes, which she is not responsible for, then it can be managed for all of us. That woman is still alive, is on insulin because all her beta cells are beyond cure, but all other medications gone away. Normal blood pressure, no medications for cholesterol, gained about 12 kgs of weight, no further diabetic gangrene, and everything under control. So if this can happen to her, if food can be the medicine, why do I need to put in chemicals into my body? And over the period of time, I learned one more thing. Science goes by the way that how is a medicine developed? Somebody gets a data, use some creature as a guinea pig, do some experiment on human beings, try it on a bunch of group, and then put it to use on general public. This is the way it goes. So they assume that every chemical is safe unless proved unsafe. But the reality is, every chemical is unsafe unless proved safe. Because we do not know, science has not grown to the point where we can know about anything and everything, at least about human biochemistry and human biology. We are still not there. Everybody with me?
Yeah.
Great. Now, I started doing such seminars in India about 3 or 4 years back. My first seminar was, I quit my medical practice and then I went into lifestyle training. I sure prescribe medicines though. When nothing else works, we have to. That's my profession because, first of all, keeping somebody alive is very important. If somebody is not alive, I can't bring in changes. Okay? So, why I started that? We are carrying a certain image as human beings in the context of food cravings and exercising. I mean, people in the food industry and people in the exercise industry, they have an image about us. I mean, people who develop those exercise programs, people who are into food industry, who are doctors who are working with food industry, people who work on the flavoring in the food industry, they have a certain image. And that image is not good. And when I show you that image, you may laugh, but we laughed, me and one of my friends, she's here, we laughed at it, we laughed at that out, but then I can't stop thinking about it, and that image is this. What can you find here?
We missed that party.
My wife had to cook dinner for me that night. See?
After your workout, right?
They did not mention that.
All right.
They said, if you, and mind you, this is the cheapest gym in the town. They charge $5 for 15 days, and they offer free pizza. And that is what exercise industry, supposedly a health industry, is doing. What's my image on that? What do they think? They think that, and one of the people who is an attendant there, she said, oh, people come with their families to have free pizza. I'm not that. None of us. Even if I go there and have my free pizza, I'm not that. I'm not there for my free pizza. They are imposing something on me for which I'm not there. I never joined a gym to get free pizza. Okay, so we are not talking about any issue that is confined to this room, confined to this city, town, province, country. We are talking about something global. I am from India. When I landed here about 100 days back, 3.5 months, with an expectation that I'm going to see some change in a developed world in comparison to a developing country. In terms of diet, in terms of awareness, in terms of making choices. But I could not see a change. There is no change. Because this is what they say, WTO, World Trade Organization, so free trade. So we are trading goods and we are trading diseases. Something that's going on in America and Canada has to happen in India. If somebody is suffering from lifestyle diseases here, somebody has to suffer in India. Why? Because all of us are being fed the same thing. All of us are being guided the same way. Let's look at some of the statistics. This is a chart of diabetes prevalence. I downloaded this chart from International Diabetes Federation, Wall Street Journal, and it says diabetes prevalence in 2013, it's 2016, and the numbers have gone up by 20%. So you lie in somewhere in the range of 6 to 9% of our total population has diabetes, and this country lies here, China, India, lies here in the range of 9 to 12%. Have a look at these, you know? This is the Middle East group, Kuwait, Iraq, and they are lying in more than 12%. Keep this data in mind, we'll come back to it. Second, obesity. Age standardized obesity in men aged 18 years and above, and the BMI is considered above 30 kilogram per meter square is considered obese. The crown of America. More than 25%. So every one in four is not a good number. It is not a good number. And look down there, Australia.
No kidding.
Right? Keep this in mind. Next. Estimated mean cholesterol. I've taken it for males because males are more at the risk for heart disease in comparison to women. So age 15 plus, data, I could not find data for 2015, so I took it for 2010, but I know that changes from 2010 to 2015 are somewhere in the range of 15 to 17%. So let's have a look. You have some respite there. China does not. Australia does not. Right? And can you see any area which is not getting it? Despite the one where we have no data, this is the disputed part of India. And that part, we have no data for that. Nobody is saved. Now let's have a look at the projections. Where are we going to lie? My problem is not that I am going to be the part of this. My problem is my son is going to be the part of that. That is my problem. And my son is going to be the part of that unless something happens on the level of society, countries, and globe. And if that does not happen, my son is going to be the part of it. So the projection is the Americas in 2000 were 33 million in number as far as prevalence of diabetes was concerned. And by 2030, we are halfway through, mind you, and it's going to double. Europe, it's going to be 1.5 times. Middle East, 3 times. You remember, Middle East has highest prevalence of obesity and diabetes? Mm-hmm. So, Africa, 7 million to 18.2 million, 2.5 times. Asia and Australia, 82.7 million to 190.5 million, 2.25 times. What's going on? What's going on? And somebody sitting here thinks, oh my God, what's happening to me? What wrong did I do? I am sorry for all those patients whom I treated brutally because I thought that they were at fault, because now I know all of us in this whole world cannot be at fault. Are we all out of our minds?
Just 1%.
That doesn't relate to this issue, at least. Even if we are, that doesn't relate to this issue. It can't go from this end to that end if all of us are out of mind. Only then it can happen. And we are not. Because, see, we could... I came to know about this seminar about 30 days ago. We advertised it. And 75 people are here. What does that show? We are aware. We are not out of our minds. We know what's going on. And we know how, we know that we want to be out of it. We don't want to be part of this. But individual efforts are not going to pay. Because it is not an individual problem. It is not your fault, so you cannot solve it. That doesn't mean you can't do anything about it, but you are not responsible for it. You are just being part of, see, if I say somebody who is obese, somebody who is diabetic, has a problem because he ate sugar, so that means somebody got lung cancer because he lives in Beijing, which has the highest pollution in the world. So if somebody has to breathe in that air, so does that make him responsible to get that lung cancer or asbestosis or whatever? No. Who is responsible? Air. So in this case, we can't be responsible. Who is? Well, we'll come back to that question. Who is responsible? Ultimately, I want to go there. Evolution. How many of you know that about, in fact, many of you know because you have seen your previous generations here. How many of you know that before 1960, this was not the state? I know before 1960, this was not the case. The globe was not sick of life. Nobody knows?
It started about 1940 in America. It started going bad.
Yeah, but before 1960, it was not a global problem, right? Okay. Why? Some problem happened, and the evolution changed to this. Right?
Looks corn fed.
Maybe. Yeah, right on. Right on. But just imagine, we actually messed up everything that happened in millions of years in just 28 years. We are so efficient. We have no respect for our forefathers. They did so much to grow up, and now we are growing here. See? What happened in these 28 years? The mortality rate has gone down. People who die of diseases, that rate has gone down. Medical science has gone up. What's going on? Why the quality of life has decreased? Why can't I stand for 2 hours? Why do I have to sit? Why can't I run for 5K? Why do I have to rest? Why can't I eat what I want to? Why do I have to eat what I'm offered? Why does the normal food means eating out? I suggest somebody to eat at home, and they say that peer pressure is so much that they get their peer pressure in a way that, why are you dieting? Why can't you go out? You don't have to do that. What changed in these 28 years? Why this normalcy is changed? Why this is not normal? Why do we say that carrying some amount of fat or carrying this amount of fat or eating this amount of something is moderate, is normal, is considered very good? Why? USDA came up with food recommendations in 1980. Okay? And why did that happen? Why was there a need for any dietary recommendation? What happened in 1980? In fact, after World War II, when we look at the data post-World War II in 1970s, the number of deaths from heart diseases was on a rise. The period of baby boomers, the number of deaths due to heart disease was on a rise. It was rising very abruptly. So, few of the scholars who were in power, who had a word, they sat down, they called their friends, who were doctors, who were surgeons, who were into lifestyle diseases that time, they called them up. What's going on? What is the issue? So they came up with a reason. They said, when we do an autopsy, familiar with the term. So when we do an autopsy, we cut down the heart and the blood vessels and we see that they are blocked. And then they ask them, what's that? From where does the blockage come? They say it's triglycerides. So what's triglycerides? They say it's fat. Okay? Reason known, simple solution. Lower down the fats. So first food recommendation came in 1980. And this was the food pyramid that came up. Everybody is familiar with that, right? Mm-hmm. Who follows it? It says, eat about 6 to 11 servings of bread, cereal, rice, and pasta a day. 2 to 4 servings of fruits. 3 to 5 servings of vegetables, 2 to 3 servings of milk, 2 to 3 servings of meat, poultry, fish, dry beans, eggs, nuts, and use sparingly fats, oils, and sweets. Are you nuts? How can I have all this stuff? But who follows? I follow. Who follows? Who tries to follow? Who tries to follow? Okay. In all, who would like to follow? I want more hands. Anyways, so they said that let's take the food out of your diet because food is something that's causing this all stuff. The heart disease is going up and that's coming up. Although, later on, in the recent years, some more data came out which said during the same period, they did not look at how many people went into smoking. The data about smoking was not there for that era. And that was the period in 1980s. If you remember, the tobacco companies were started to be sued. Remember? For hiding the facts and everything, that you don't tell us that it causes this, it causes that, and now we know taking tobacco in any form causes heart disease, right? Anyways, so something happened and they did that. And it's going till now. 2015, USDA came up with the latest recommendations. They have changed this pyramid to a food plate. Nothing has changed except that here there's no sugar. And the recommendations on this plan was that no more than 20% of your daily calories should come from sugars, and now they have reduced it to 10%. So they say that sugar is bad, some data is coming up, sugar is bad, so try to reduce it. So out of 2,000 calories that you eat every day, no more than 200 calories a day should come up from sugar. 200 calories divided by 4 means 50, divided by another 4 means somewhere around 12.5 teaspoons of sugar. No more than 12.5 teaspoons of sugar a day. Okay? So according to USDA, If you take less than 12.5 grams of sugar a day, that's a healthy diet. The most recent recommendations, right? There's another article. When I look there, everybody is having a look. I'm not blocking somebody, yet. Okay. So, percentage of obese people in comparison to number of years and decades. What happened? This is where food recommendations came up. And obesity levels for all the age groups started going up till 2005 and 2006. I have data till 2005 and 2006, and it has not stopped. Okay? And what else happened with obesity? What are the comorbidities? What else obesity gives? Idiopathic intracranial hypertension. Anybody who is hypertensive has high blood pressure, and there is no reason to it. The reason is obesity. So idiopathic means no reason. So that is one of the comorbidity. Stroke, cataracts, coronary heart disease, diabetes, dyslipidemia, hypertension, severe pancreatitis, cancers. These are all lifestyle cancers. Breast, uterus, cervix, colon, esophagus, pancreas, kidney, prostate, phlebitis. Somebody see those, have seen those inflamed veins? Okay? Gout. Skin problems, like those inflammatory skin diseases with no cause. Osteoarthritis, and somebody said it's aging. Well, gynecological abnormalities, PCOD, very common, very, very common these days. Girls of 26, 30, 34 years of age not able to conceive because of PCOD. Gallbladder diseases, non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. There was a reason to a fatty liver disease some years back, alcohol. And now, the number of people who suffer from non-alcoholic fatty liver disease is way up than the people who suffer from alcoholic fatty liver disease. And pulmonary diseases, lung diseases, abnormal function, obstructive sleep apnea, hypoventilation syndrome, people who snore. Because obesity went up, swallowing. Everybody agrees? Okay. But why it failed? We were right on our path.
Body needs
fats. Yep.
Healthy fats.
Yep. Healthy fats or whatever. But we still eat fats, no? Who doesn't eat fat? You don't eat fat? I eat about 50% of my calories from fat. And I eat about 3,000 calories a day. So 1500 calories, 50% of my calories come from fat. I'm not recommending anything, I'm just suggesting. I'm just sharing. Why low fat failed? Now, when you take fat out of food, tasteless. I'm still from a country where we take about 7 to 8% of fat in milk. And somebody told me, if you try to sell that kind of milk here, they will put you to jail. And we are the largest producer of milk in the world. And 7 to 8% milk. And you know what? There's a tradition in India. We take milk before going to bed every night. It is a tradition. We have to do that. And it's not skimmed. It's not 2%, it's not 1%, it's 7 to 8% buffalo milk.
Is it pasteurized?
Yes, yeah, we boil it on our own.
Oh, you do it.
Yeah.
Oh, interesting.
Okay, so now when I'm sorry, for how long?
No, cow or goat. No.
Yeah, cow, goat, and buffalo, but majority is buffalo. Yeah, so now when I try to drink milk here, I cannot. I simply cannot because I don't know what it tastes like. It has no taste. And same way, we used to cook regular bread at home some years back. We still do that in India. We make parathas. Some of you have heard of naans. They are fried. Are they better than the regular bread? Fat. Naan. And we eat like three times a day. Three times a day, 2 to 3 naans, everybody. And home-cooked cereals. We used to fry our cereals before cooking, before serving. Because fat is bad, we stopped that. No fat, I'm getting fat, no fat. Now, not because everything was taken out of your food. Just imagine how would your cereal taste without fat. But now there was a problem. You can't stop human beings from eating. So what happened? This happened. Something is required. And now USDA says 6 to 11 servings of carbohydrates a day and 20% of calories coming from sugar, added sugar, that means sugar is fine. Sugar was brought into the picture. Okay? And this is the end result. This is the result. 80% of the food items in US grocery stores are spiked with added sugar. Somebody gifted my wife, she's here, a pack of ginger and lemon chews yesterday. I told her not to open. She did not listen to me. Now, after she chewed on one, we had to put that to garbage. Every serving of 30 grams had 23 grams of sugar. And now, there was one more gift. What was it? Chocolate covered potato chips. I mean, chocolate covered potato chips. Why would not I eat sugar and salt together mixed in my bowl?
But this time I listened to him and I didn't do
it. So, this is what's going on. And by 2050, right now the condition is that every 1 in 3 Americans is pre-diabetic. They can still reverse it. And by 2050, every 1 of 3 Americans will be diabetic. And every time WHO comes with such a data, that this is the projected score, we outnumber it. So this may happen in 2030. Coming back. Now, sugar. Most loved thing. 56 names. Who has two names here? I have two.
You have two.
I have two. Who has three?
I have three.
Who has four? Sugar has 56. You have all. These are the 56 names.
Oh my God.
Barley malt, Barbados sugar, and you know what? Now we have 59. I'll tell you three more which are not here. And we just came across coconut sugar. Beet sugar? Mm-hmm. And who thinks coconut sugar is healthy in comparison to the normal sugar? Who thinks so? You think so? Let's get to there in a while. Yeah. So now they don't write sugar. Now every food company knows that if you write sugar, you lose some of the customers. So what do they write? They write cane juice, cane sugar, caramel, corn syrup, corn syrup solids, dextrose, dextran, dehydrated cane juice, this is my favorite, and dextrose, yeah, fruit juice concentrate,
fructose,
galactose, glucose, high fructose corn syrup, honey, icing sugar, invert sugar, maltodextrin, maltose, malt syrup. Yesterday I was looking at a protein powder. It said zero maltodextrin, zero sugar. And in ingredients, they wrote sorbitol and rice syrup, yeah. Wow. What are you trying to do? You are trying to make fool of the customers? This is what's going on. Anyways, let's not go to their intentions. Let's see what's going on, okay? So everybody with me? I'm not boring, eh? Okay.
No.
Now, where do you find sugar? Bread. I'm not talking about yours.
everywhere.
Yeah, your bread doesn't have sugar. She's from Murillo. So.
Murillo bacon,
yeah.
Right?
So, the sugar has invaded everything from bread, cereals, pop, chocolate, milk, foods. Right? I could not write more. I was tired. Now, the love of sugar has grown so much that it is now in air, love, celebrations, everywhere. How? An example. Here's an example.
Yeah.
You know, if you open a bottle of Coca-Cola, that means happiness.
Yeah.
Right? And if you eat at McDonald's, that means you are in love. Wow. When was this guy, I don't know, when did he get fat? Because, yeah, they still don't believe it. Because, but I mean, he replaced roses for sure. You take somebody out to McDonald's because you love her or him, right? One more example. Who says hi, fatty? But everybody says hi, honey. Right? Okay, and if you tell somebody hi, honey, you may get a kiss back, right? And if you say hi, fatty. let's be little other way, not offending, but let's say high protein, high muscle, doesn't work, right? So this is our love of sugar. This is mine. Okay? Now, what were the expectations for the low-fat diet? Why did they introduce those dietary guidelines? The low calorie intake, right? 1 gram of fat provides you with 9 calories, and 1 gram of carbohydrates gives you 4 calories, and 1 gram of protein also gives you 4 calories. Now, 1 gram of fat gives you 9 calories, that means that is more than double the amount in comparison to carbohydrates and protein. So if you take away fat, you are reducing the number of calories that you take, right? Right. So low calorie intake, as fats are the highest caloric producer per gram in comparison to carbs and proteins. Those were the expectations, and that was what we expected it to do. That if we go low fat, we are reducing the number of calories everybody takes, right? Food pyramid was also introduced with the belief that fat in diet is the cause of the increasing rates of heart diseases in the US population because it clogs vascular system. We have discussed about it, right? I told you that story, in fact. Now, what's the outcome? Yeah, right. The total caloric intake in the human population has increased by 300 calories on an average per day since food pyramid guidelines. We were consuming 2,000 calories per day in 1980, and now we are consuming somewhere around 2,100 calories each day. The main source of these calories has been shifted. It's no more fat. Because everybody who is aware stays away from the butter, stays away from the fat, stays away from the yolk of the egg, stays away from the red meat.
Fructose.
Is the word. That's carbohydrate, not fat. Right?
Fructose,
so, but the source changed to carbohydrates. Carbohydrates, in particular, those 56 names of sugar. How? Yeah, one more thing. The other reason to introduce that was that number of cardiovascular disease should go down, right? And we just saw that data, number of cardiovascular disease has gone over. Way, way over. Uncontrollable. And other metabolic disease and comorbidities also have risen, right? Now this is what happened. in the year 1966. Now, this is the per capita food consumption for the US, and I have targeted sugar and sweeteners in individual and come up with that data, and this data is directly from USDA website. Okay, the last updated was on December 21, 2004. I could not get beyond that because now they don't have the data for last 10 years, so they're still working on it, or they don't want me to know. Anyways, they don't want us to know. So in the year 1975 and 1974 to 1978, those changes were happening, and 1980s when those dietary guidelines were introduced, the average consumption of cane and beet sugar started coming down a bit, and since 1986 it's on a level of more or less the same level, right? But what is this coming up here? This thing. This is corn syrup. This is high fructose corn syrup. Any idea what's high fructose corn syrup?
Fructose?
High fructose corn syrup.
Yes.
What is it?
It's made from corn.
Yeah, it can be made from corn. Your coconut sugar is also HFCs.
Yeah.
Yeah, beet sugar also HFCs. Any sugar that comes out of any fruit is high fructose corn syrup. If granulated, it's sugar. If not, it's syrup. So it started going up to the levels that it met sugar. So before that, we were consuming sugar. And now we are consuming both in equal quantities. There's a small difference in sugar, normal sugars, and fructose, high fructose corn syrup. Chemical difference. Our body does not process it the same way as it does sugar. Our body does not process fructose the same way as it processes sugar. It does not. Because it has a different chemical formula. Table sugar is 50% sucrose, glucose, and 50% fructose. So it's an evenly matched structure. HFCS is 45:55. 55% fructose and rest glucose. And there's one more formula, which is 90% fructose and 10% glucose. Now, why would they start using HFCS? Cheap. Mm-hmm. Dirt cheap.
And very concentrated.
Second, it is about 16 times more concentrated than sugar. Mm-hmm. So if you have to put like 16 tablespoons of sugar, you put 1 tablespoon of HFCS, you're done.
It's addictive.
One more data. We have talked about it before. The calories that are coming from fat are reduced by 10%. From 1960s to 2010 thereabouts. And the prevalence of obesity has doubled or tripled. Sources of what from now 300 extra calories, right? It may shock you. Everybody who is present here, all of you, consume 26 teaspoons of sugar every day. You can't doubt it. Who consumes 26 teaspoons of sugar every day? Who does? 26 teaspoons of sugar every day? Right. No, don't believe this. Don't believe this guy. Like 26 teaspoons. I could, even if I try, I will fail.
That'd be 2 cans of pop.
Nobody can do that, right? But if 300 calories are coming, it has to have a source, because we are looking at the results, and the results are global and very bad. We are suffering from that. We cannot ignore the results. The results are already there. We are all getting fatty. We are all getting diabetic. We are all getting all those comorbidities which come with obesity. We can't ignore it. So where are these 300 calories coming from? Where is this sugar coming from? This is the data for HFCS, high fructose corn syrup. These are the three varieties, 42, 55, 99. About 99% times, 55% and 90% is used. And there is Canada. And there is USA. Highest. Right? And that is 25 kilograms per capita per year. And Canada is at around 10. 1 kilogram of HFCS per capita per month. 35 grams every day. Nine teaspoons every day. And I do not have a bottle of corn syrup in my refrigerator. None of you have. From where is this coming? Before we get to the answers, let's try to answer this question. Why human body reacted against this hypothesis of low fat? Most of you know it, but one more thing, that you have always been fat. If you keep your calories balanced, say I eat 2,000 calories, I burn 2,000 calories, I'll be at the same weight, right? Right? So if I eat high caloric food and I go to gym, I should be fine. That means athletes should not be obese, athletes should not be diabetics. And I can at least give thousands of examples where athletes are diabetics, athletes are obese, and they are suffering from the same thing. And now if they cannot do it, how can I? How can you all? Now, this is a mathematical equation, right? Simple addition, subtraction. Let's believe it for the time being, as we have believed till date. But one more thing. Is human body's hormonal response to your diet is mathematical? Does your body count calories? Who eats carbohydrates? Raise your hand. I bet none of you do. You eat food. None of you eat carbohydrates. None of you eat fats. None of you eat proteins. I told you that, or science told you that this is carbohydrate, this is fat. You ate food. So your body does not recognize anything. It just processes it the way it is designed to. So your body's hormonal response is not same to every food. Everybody has experienced that after eating certain kind of food, we feel energetic, and after eating other kind of food, we feel bad. Right? And somebody else may be opposite. Why? Because all of us, we have a different hormonal response. Although there is a baseline where we all are same, but it's still different individually. We will look at this hormonal response in a bit. Now, according to this hormonal response, I learned a calorie is not a calorie. If that would have been the case, then a diabetic should be allowed to take 2,000 calories every day that he needs from sugar, and if he does not eat anything else, it should be fine. Shouldn't it be? If somebody who is obese and needs 2,000 calories a day and takes them from sugar or fat or anything, then we never needed that food pyramid. Right? Because at the end of the day, I am just dealing with a mathematical equation. The source of this energy is very important. Because 1 gram of fat is different, 1 gram of protein is different, and 1 gram of carbohydrate is different. And then there are subcategories. Not all carbohydrates are processed in the same way. Now, our body treats carbohydrates in a very, very different manner. One carbohydrate is processed by one organ, other carbohydrate is used as a fuel by every cell in the body. And it's not same with all the carbohydrates. Let's have a look at the differences. Three main sources of macronutrition, everybody agrees? Carbohydrates, fats, and proteins, right?
Yes.
Let's look at the proteins. Everybody is familiar with the term amino acid? Amino acids are the basically basic molecular structures of the proteins, right? And every cell in our body is protein, right? Okay, so building blocks of the body. So there are two kinds of proteins. There's a reason that I'm mentioning that, coming deviating from the topic. There are two kinds of amino acids which complete the molecular structure to develop or to make or regenerate every cell of our body. I'm moving my hand, I'm killing my cells. I'm clapping, I'm killing my cells. I need regeneration. I'm doing a push-up, I'm killing my body. I need regeneration, and I need these. Now, there are two kinds. One is essential, one is non-essential. Everybody is familiar with the term? What's essential? What is an essential amino acid? Anybody?
Your body can't produce it. So
your body cannot produce it. That is why it has been termed essential. You have to take it from outside. Non-essential, your body can manufacture it. Whatever you give to your body, it will manufacture it, depending upon when it needs it, right? And these are fatty acids. Now, fatty acids, I did not do it the way I did with proteins because none of you have believed, but there are essential fats. There are fats which our body cannot produce but needs it. Essential fatty acids that cannot be synthesized in the human body and must be taken in adequate amounts in the diet and are required for normal growth and metabolism. Any woman who is low in her diet in fat during pregnancy may have a baby which is deficient in brain function, nervous function, and immunity. Because these three systems of our body are totally dependent on fat in their development and in their functioning. So now they are essential fatty acids, right? So first macronutrient was protein, essential and non-essential. Second macronutrient was fat, essential and non-essential. Third macronutrient is carbohydrate. No essential, no non-essential. Food pyramid says we need it and we take it. Simple as that. But in body what happens? There is a term called gluconeogenesis. Gluco means glucose, neo means new, genesis means production. Got it? Defined as biosynthesis of glucose from non-carbohydrate precursors. The major non-carbohydrate precursors is lactate, amino acids, glycerol, and carbon skeletons of the most amino acids. So our body can actually produce glucose from protein, right? Non-carbohydrate precursors of glucose are first converted into pyruvate or oxaloacetate and DHAP. These are precursors of the glucose which convert to glucose as and when required. Now, if somebody is fasting, most of the body's glucose needs are met by gluconeogenesis. Occurs mainly in the liver and to some extent in the kidney. Responsible for 64% of the total glucose production in first 22 hours of the fast and then almost all the glucose production by 46 hours. So if we are not taking any carbohydrates but are taking enough amount of amino acids or precursors which body can use to produce glucose, it can do it efficiently, right? So does that make all the carbohydrates non-essential? Yes or no? Do we need them?
Yes.
Our body can manufacture it. Our body can totally manufacture the amount of glucose that it needs. Every cell in the body utilizes glucose as the main fuel. Every cell in the body. So our body cannot be in a system, cannot be in any kind of state where it cannot produce glucose. unless you are suffering from some kind of enzymatic hormonal deficiencies, that is another case. But our body cannot be in a state where it cannot produce glucose if it is getting right kind of precursors. Because every cell needs glucose as an energy. This is what happens to our blood sugar level when we eat different micronutrients, fat, protein, and carbohydrate. When we eat a carbohydrate, anything sugar, the blood sugar spikes, goes down. Time taken, minimal. An easy example would be, I drink a pop, full of about, one pop would have maybe depending on size from 12 to 36 teaspoons of sugar. I drink it, and I'll be hungry after 30 minutes, 40 minutes, right? And if we eat protein, any source, fish, seafood, chicken, whatever, the blood glucose spikes. Why? Because amino acids are precursors to gluconeogenesis. And fat, the blood glucose level never spikes. You eat fat, nothing happens to your blood glucose levels. Now, if nothing happens to my blood glucose level, that means I can't be in a state of diabetes. Right? That's what diabetes is. If my blood glucose level goes up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down, that is diabetes. Not in a constant state of flurry or metabolic syndrome up and down. And if I can achieve this state, I won't have that issue. And now coming to the insulin response, hormonal response. As I said, not all foods are processed same way. Plasma insulin response. I'm actually coming back to only carbohydrates, because carbohydrates gave the real spike, right? So there are two basic kinds of carbohydrates that we are having these days. You remember those two curves? We were eating sugar and then HFCS came up and met, right? So two kinds of sugars. One is fructose, one is glucose. So this is what insulin response to these two sugars is. We have something which has glucose, any cereal, any, it happens, it occurs in every food in the world, right? Any food that is produced by nature. Insulin level goes up, stays normal, and then comes down as blood sugar comes down. But for fructose, there is no high. So insulin is not responsive to fructose, right? So that means if I am eating HFCS, I may not require insulin. But why? It is a sugar. Insulin has to get it down, because whenever I am eating some sugar, it is a state of turbulence in my body. My body does not want to be in that state anymore, and it releases insulin to calm it down, calm that storm down. I do not want, my body doesn't want to be in the state of storm. Now, why is that difference? I'm going to that difference after this slide. Functions of insulin. Now, insulin is a very anabolic hormone. Whatever in your body happens in terms of regeneration, insulin has a very, very important role in it. Why? Because insulin stimulates the uptake of glucose by muscles and adipose tissue. Adipose tissue is the fatty tissue. So when you have an insulin sugar spike, insulin comes in, tells glucose to go to every cell in the body, to go to brain, to every muscle, and fill up the glycogen stores. And if there is still something left, go to fatty tissue and be there for the future use, right? It stimulates glycolysis. It helps you in promoting glycogen decline, muscle glycogen decline. Helps in glycogenesis also, because glucose level goes up, goes into muscle tissue, glycogen stores build up. Stimulates protein synthesis. No regeneration can happen without insulin. Inhibits gluconeogenesis. Remember gluconeogenesis? Our body's ability to produce its own glucose, insulin shuts it down. Because there's already enough glucose in the blood, we do not need more. So it tells liver to sit back and relax. and it inhibits lipolysis. It doesn't allow fat to be used as energy source. Now coming to the metabolic differences of glucose and fructose. Your body metabolizes fructose in a very different way than glucose. After eating fructose, 100% of that metabolic burden rests on your liver, but with glucose, your liver has to break down only 20% because rest of the glucose is used up by every cell in the body for the regular functioning instantly. Instantly. I'm talking, I need energy, I eat some glucose, my glucose is going to be used up. Every cell in your body, including your brain, utilizes glucose. Therefore, much of it is burned up immediately after you consume it. But in contrast, fructose is converted into three kinds of fatty acids. Everybody recognizes them. VLDL, triglycerides. What are these two fatty acids? Whenever VLDL and triglycerides rise in our blood, doctor says, come on, go on in aspirin, go on statins, right? Because these are going to clog your arteries. We reduce fat so that we can get rid of this. And now, we are having fructose, which is making it, you know, manufacturing it in our body. Glucose, when we eat glucose in any form, any regular, natural form, it releases certain hormones and suppresses ghrelin. Now, ghrelin is hunger hormone. When we feel hungry, ghrelin is released. We eat something, shuts down. Glucose shuts it down. Fructose does not. Because fructose is a big molecular structure, it cannot reach to brain telling it, oh, shut down the hunger center. I'm not hungry anymore, I've eaten something. So you eat fructose, you still crave more because your brain doesn't know that you have eaten anything. So, if these are the diseases that we have talked about before, now I'm just going to put some words about metabolic syndrome. Metabolic syndrome is pre-diabetes. There's a diabetes, there's a pre-diabetes, and there's a pre-diabetes. Many of us here are in that state already. Insulin resistance, your body does not respond to insulin anymore. You eat sugar, your insulin comes up to shut it down, your body doesn't listen. How many times will it listen? If you keep slapping somebody, he'll go numb. That's what we do to our body. Elevated blood pressure, abdominal obesity. Fat accumulated around here. Waist more than 40, abdominal obesity and metabolic syndrome. Look down, can't look at your feet, metabolic syndrome. You are a customer to that pharmaceutical company who sells diabetic pills. Oxidative stress, inflammation, fatty liver, endothelial dysfunction. This is what causes coronary artery disease and hyperuricemia, gout. Everything that we eat, from fatty acids to protein, has some role. We don't eat fat, we will not be able to build healthy cells. We will lose our brain and our function. And everybody knows, we don't eat omega-3s, you are at a risk for developing cardiovascular disease, right? But what's that? That's fat. Same way, protein, everything. You need to have a regeneration, you want to go anti-aging, you need protein. Now coming back to the question, if you do not eat 26 teaspoons of sugar a day, where is it coming from? It's coming from everywhere. Cereals, fruit juices, and even fat loss cereals, Special K. Intended to lose fat, but it's giving you fructose. I was very happy that I found it. Look there.
Yeah.
Right? I was very happy. I'm trying to break it down for you. Okay? Now, what does this McRib bun has? It has enriched flour, right? Why would you enrich a flour?
Because you took good stuff out in the first
place. Yes, because it is white. You have to enrich it. So they want to say white flour. Because they are saying, now they don't say, they don't want you to know that it's white. So they say bleached white, bleached flour. I bleached it. Strange. Malted barley flour. Why would you malt down a barley flour? Reduced iron, niacin, and then coming to this, high fructose corn syrup in this bread, right? And this is the bread that you buy at Walmart too. The regular bread that has sugar in addition to high fructose corn syrup. Partially hydrogenated soybean, dextrose. Why would you write sugar in, like, next to dextrose? They are same. Because we have a tendency to read sugar. Who would read high fructose corn syrup, dextrose, sugar, and then coming down here, these are all sugars. Mono and diglycerides, I don't read it. Ethoxylated mono and diglycerides. And then middle part, McRib pork patty, again has dextrose. McRib sauce, high fructose corn syrup, distilled vinegar, molasses, another name for sugar, natural smoked flavor, plant starch modified. When you modify a starch, it becomes easily digested. So you're taking away the perspective, why would you take starch? You take starch because it doesn't break down very easily, it doesn't raise your blood glucose, and you modified it. And then sugar, and then caramel color, beet powder. Now coming to pickle. Polysorbate 80. That's the recent name for sugar. Whose fault is it? I was just hungry, man. I was just hungry. You fed me diabetes. You fed me a storm. Now this is your fat loss cereal. A cereal which has low fat. Cereal, rice, whole grain wheat. They don't say what? Bleached. So, little better. Sugar, wheat bran. Malt flavoring, maltodextrin, corn syrup. Sugar, fructose, sugar, maltodextrin, dextrose, sorbitol. What the heck? What's this? It will make me lose weight? And now if they advertise it, Special K helps you lose weight, everybody will be in the store to buy this. Because those were our expectations and they know how to deal with us, how to deal with our minds. I'm desperate to lose weight. And then they write down fat-free, 98% fat-free. Strange. Now, this is where you find high fructose corn syrup. Somebody wants a list, I can print it out. But I can read it out. It will be morning by that time. But you know what? Everything you eat, just everything you eat. Everything. Did you tell these companies to put in sugar and high fructose corn syrup in your food? Is this food? These cereals here that I feed to my kid? All of us feed to ourselves and our kids? Did I tell them to put this high fructose corn syrup which is making triglycerides and whatnot? When your liver processes high fructose corn syrup or any kind of fructose, it cannot be used by the cells of your body as energy. Where does it go? It goes into the visceral fat. There are two kinds of fat. Love handles are not bad because they are subcutaneous, they are just below the skin. They are required to save us from cold temperature. It's the thermal insulation of the body. But when you get fat around your organs, your organs have no space to breathe. How will they work? That is why you get fatty liver, fatty pancreas, gallbladder stones. How would they work? How would your organs work? Now we all know that it's bad, no? I was kind of telling the already told story. But why? You can't break this cycle. Not possible. You eat sugar, you crave it, because it's addictive. How it's addictive, I'll come to this. The blood sugar levels go up, right? Your body has a lot of energy, right? Dopamine is released in the brain. Dopamine is a neurotransmitter. It is a molecule that makes your neuromuscular junctions work. Nerves come down, muscles work, everything, you know. When it is raised, you feel more active. Hilarious. You feel like on the top of the world. So dopamine is released. And that dopamine gives you that sugar high. Have you ever heard of cocaine high? This is sugar high. But your body doesn't like it. Your body is afraid that more excitement may stop your heart. It releases insulin. Blood levels go down. We don't like it. Who likes to be lazy? Blood sugar levels fall very rapidly. High insulin levels cause immediate fat storage, because all the time we don't need that sugar. All the time we are not in the need of that high intensity energy thing. Body craves the lost sugar high. Hungers and cravings. Low blood sugar, I feel those cravings. I feel hungry. My body demands more. I go to that McDonald's again. I have no choice. Now, ethanol, alcohol. See the difference between chronic ethanol exposure and chronic fructose exposure. No difference. No difference at all. The only difference is alcohol after a limit will tell you top down. Fructose will not, because it is slow poison. You take small every day. But at the end of the day, same result, because alcohol is processed by the liver and fructose is processed by the liver. And there is no way to go.
Poor liver.
These are PET scans. Can you see some similarity or something like that? Can you really compare these? These are the dopamine activity in the brain of a smoker in comparison to a non-smoker. Our brain is full of dopamine receptors, full of it. So if you smoke, this is your dopamine activity. If you're an alcoholic, these are the centers which get dopamine activity. If you're obese, this, and if you are cocaine dependent, this. 1, 2, and 3. Can you see the similarity? Same center is activated, which gets activated when we get rewarded. Your body treats sugar high as cocaine high, as alcohol high, as any other reward. And we always need those rewards. So these are the interpretations. Sugar, just like in the short term cocaine use, gives a sugar high, makes us feel alert, happy, energetic and active. Everybody has felt that sometime or the other in the life. However, at the same time also makes us addictive of that sugar high. On a chronic use, our body needs more amount of sugar to produce same level of sugar high. If I'm eating this much amount of sugar to attain this much amount of sugar high, for this much sugar high, next time I will need this. That's what is called That is what is called addiction. Same is the case with heroin, cocaine, everything. However, body is smart. Nature was smart. Just like when we are taking alcohol, it gives us signals to stop down. After a while, it gives us signals to stop down on fructose. What are those signals? On a longer term, obesity, when we're eating that fructose, we are getting that visceral fat, we're getting our waistlines bigger, that obesity slows down the dopamine activity. Because adipose tissue, fat cell, acts like an endocrine organ in itself. It releases about 13 different hormones in itself. Now, when there will be a low dopamine, it will lead to this. Chronic depression and fatigue, restless leg syndrome, excess sleep, low libido, sex drive, ADHD, aggressive behavior, apathetic and socially withdrawn. And we thought that ADHD people need more chemicals. They're already suffering. And we thought that our kids got ADHD because there is some issue with something else. It's an issue with their diets. It's an issue with what the mother ate when she was pregnant. It's an issue what she fed her kid when he was cranky. Now, after all this, what would the outcome of this low dopamine, obesity, and all the stuff? This is a normal thing that happens in the body. We eat glucose, insulin comes in, but after a while, when insulin is released, like I told you, if you keep slapping somebody, it goes numb. Your cells stop listening to insulin because they do not have enough space. It's enough of glucose for me. I am shutting the door down for glucose. I am not listening to you, insulin. Sorry. My home is full. I do not want any more insulin. And that is when insulin resistance develops. That is type 2 diabetes. And type 2 diabetes means all those comorbidities. Anybody who is in the stage of metabolic syndrome should be ready for this. Now, these are the conditions that get associated with insulin resistance. Just a reminder, we went through all this before. Remember? Cancers, phlebitis, pancreatitis, diabetes, dyslipidemia, idiopathic infantile hypertension, pulmonary diseases, diabetes, disease, and what not, right? Now, how would you know that you have insulin resistance? What would be the clinical presentation? Is this you? Fatigue. Oh, I did not do that much, but I'm fatigued. Constant hunger. Inability to lose weight. Cravings for sugar. Fatigue or sleep. Feeling sleepy, drowsy after meals, migraines, upper abdominal obesity, increased fat storage around waistline. Is this you? Any of you who experience this is on the verge of getting clinical insulin resistance because insulin resistance has already developed. It's only a matter of time, it's going to show up in your blood. Once it shows up, all this, there has to be some outlet. It can come out as low thyroid, it can come out as high triglycerides and cholesterol, it can come out as PCOD, estrogen dominance, and people think there is a special diet to estrogen dominance. Where is the special diet? No special diet. You just need to know your facts. Now, this is where we started. Who is responsible? I'm not. And whomsoever I advised ever in my life, whomsoever I took out of these issues ever in my life, was not responsible. Because if he came to me for some treatment, for some advice, he was aware. sure is not responsible. This is what is being told to you all the time. You go to doctor, you go to authorities, go anywhere. They say it's your fault. You need to change. You do not follow your exercise routine. How many times have you been told that you do not exercise enough? All the time. Oh, come on. You just did 5K. You have to do 10K. What after that? Oh my God. You just did 100 kgs of bench press. You have to do 120. What difference would it make? Because everybody believes that mathematical equation, calories in, calories out, calories in, calories out. And if that was true, again, are we out of mind that we let this epidemic happen? And that too in the era of information crisis, when we do not need to walk out of our houses and we have moving grounds in the form of treadmills. And when that treadmill keeps telling me that I have burnt 500 calories in 20 minutes, and then I am liable to get these diseases? Are you kidding me? I'm not responsible for this. What is this? Any idea? Anybody? Any guess? Any wild guess?
McDonald's.
These are... This is... Yeah, she's right.
What did she say?
She is right.
What did she say?
This, she said McDonald's.
Oh, thank you. I didn't hear
this
that.
This is the data of number of McDonald's. When we search nearest McDonald's in America, this comes up. Now, when I go for grocery in Walmart, I make healthiest of choices. Healthiest of choices. My son feels hungry and he wants to eat something. What is my choice? McDonald's in the Walmart. Right? I come out of McDonald's. I let him cry. I come out of Walmart. Opposite to Walmart, another McDonald's. By the time I reach home, I have crossed like 3 McDonald's. There's a McDonald's opposite to where I work. There's a McDonald's opposite to my house. There's a McDonald's opposite to where I do grocery shopping. And then they offer me pizza in my gym. I mean, oh. Who is responsible? Food companies? No. You know what? Food companies are trying to do something. Food companies are trying to do something. They made a back to balance coalition. They said, let's go back to balance. Let's have a balanced meal now. Made of 18 leading food groups that signed a statement of principles promoting moderation. They say, eat everything in moderation. And the motto was, all foods fit in a balanced diet. If you want to eat balance, eat moderate and eat all foods. Right? Good job. Who are these food groups? Sugar Association. Wow. National Confectioners Association, Corn Refiners Association, National Potato Council, and most potato consumption in America is through chips and fries, and the Grocery Manufacturers Association, and the members are Coca-Cola and Hershey, and the Snack Food Association. So they came up, sat on a table, and thought that we have done enough harm, let's reverse it. So they say, dear people, please eat everything in moderation. Dear manager, you did not made anything in moderation. What is there in moderation in your food store? What is there in moderation in my grocery store? There's nothing in moderation. And the statement comes up like that after their meeting. All foods can fit within healthful overall dietary pattern if consumed in moderation with appropriate portion size and combined with physical activity. So they are telling you that you are responsible to eat this much. So if you buy one burger out of me, just eat the upper bun and throw it away, but please buy the burger out of me. If you buy a cold drink, if you buy a pop, please take one sip and throw it, throw the rest of it. Please don't drink it. That's what they are trying to say. So they don't want you to stop eating their food. They want you to know that you are doing something wrong, which, according to you, or according to me, we are unaware of. When I say something in moderation, can I do something else in moderation? For example, can I abuse somebody in moderation?
No.
I'll be moderately abusive.
No.
Now just for example, I tell somebody that I'll be moderately abusive and the other guy says yes. You know what did he admit to? He admitted to there is no limit you can abuse me. Because if you allow something in moderation, there is no definition for moderation. You cannot define moderation. That's what they are doing. Now, who has $988 million in this room?
I'm getting it.
Do we all have net worth of $988 million? $9 million? All of us? I don't think so. I don't agree. Now, they spend like $988 million on advertising in 2013, and every year on an average the expenditure goes up by 3%. 3% on 988 million is a huge money. Who will fight them? Now there is a professor, Teresa Davis, in University of Sydney Business School.
Okay.
He's a good man. The statement he gave was kind of hilarious, but he's a good man. He said, the battleground between the food industry and parents is certainly not a level playing field. Advertising to kids is all pervasive. It's a multi-billion dollar industry with sophisticated, constantly evolving psychological techniques. We expect individual parents to be smarter than clever market researchers and branding experts. So he said that in my observation, in his observation, this is what needs to be done. And I did not include his next statement. He said, it's not possible. He said, you cannot teach anyone to the extent that they beat a guy who is MBA marketing. None of us can beat him. And they play on the psychology. When they say, open Coca-Cola, open happiness. When Lay's say, no one can eat just one, they are not making a claim. They are sure. No one can eat just one. But when I see it my way, I see they kind of made me believe that I cannot eat one. If I keep telling somebody you are dumb, he will go dumb. Mm-hmm. Or at least have that doubt. So they make us believe that no one can have one. And they now make us believe that eat in moderation, that we are already doing. Nobody eats breakfast, lunch, and dinner at McDonald's. No one. We are already in moderation. But who will define moderation? Who will break down that vicious cycle? Now, question is, when everything is going on, everybody knows that this is a menace, needs to be cleared up. What are the authorities doing? I talked about Indian authorities in India, but there are no Indian authorities actually. They just follow US authorities. Now, dietary reference intakes. Everybody is familiar with that term? DRI, the term DRI is used for a standard level of intake for all the nutrition things, macronutrients and micronutrients, and it is governed by these authorities. Established by Canadian and American scientists through a review process overseen by the US Institute of Medicine in collaboration with Health Canada, reflect the current state of scientific knowledge and were used to update dietary guidelines in Canada. This is what the authority is. This is the introduction to them, right? This is the authority. So if they say something, we need to believe them, right? Right? They are scientists and they are operating on Health Canada.
Who pays them?
I don't want to go into that. We would need another 2 hours. You know? Because I don't want to know who is responsible for it. I want a solution. This is the cause. I need to go to the solution. So let's see what they say. The current version of Canada's food guide encourages Canadians to limit foods and beverages high in calories, fat, sugar, and salt. Good thing. However, it is important to note that limiting these foods does not equate to avoiding them altogether. Isn't it the same thing like those food companies? Eat in moderation. Are you in an office with the Health Canada building or McDonald's building? Whom are you actually representing? And then they say many foods are made enjoyable. I mean, you're Health Canada. Many foods are made enjoyable by adding small amounts of sugar. Without sugar, many individuals may not consume healthy foods that contribute to their nutrient needs. Who told them? Where is the data? They assume that if food companies do not add sugar to my cereal, I will not eat my cereal. Let it be, I don't want to eat my cereal. Let it be. But at least give me a choice. They say, for example, without sugar, many breakfast cereals providing essential nutrients will be inedible. Now, if 60 grams of serving of a breakfast cereal has 30 grams of sugar, is it a breakfast cereal or is it a sugar cereal? Now, in addition, it doesn't end here. They say active Canadians. Who is an active Canadian? It's especially for you then. You can consume foods that are higher in sugar. Congratulations. And calories. So you can take food that is higher in calories and sugar to meet your energy demands. That's what Health Canada says. A number of foods and beverages such as lower fat cereal and bakery products and beverages such as fruit and sport drinks can provide the additional calories and carbohydrates that they require. So you can drink your pop. You can take those chocolate laden potato chips. Because you are an active Canadian or you are an active individual. But is that fructose going to spare you after 5 years? Are they trying to make you an inactive Canadian from an active Canadian? Yeah. Or the motto is to make more people active? If somebody is on cocaine and somebody doesn't take it, do we advise him to start taking cocaine because you are healthy? Well, the DRI report reviewed all available evidence. Now, they reviewed all the evidence. They reviewed all the evidence. Which evidence? That they wanted to. Right? On the effects of total, like the total sugars that we consume and the added sugars that we consume. On chronic disease risk and micronutritional intakes. Now, they say, with respect to chronic disease risk, the report concluded that there was insufficient evidence to set an upper limit for total or added sugars based on the data available on dental caries, behavior, cancer, risk of obesity, and risk of hyperlipidemia. They say there is no data that suggests that there is an upper limit for intake of sugar if you are suffering from diabetes, obesity, hyperlipidemia, or whatever. I had only 6 years of medical college. My books did not tell me that. They have more experience. They have about 10 years of medical college under them. They are representing a very responsible name. If they will not be authoritative, the cycle of power, politics, money, and business is going to eat us all. Unless we take a collaborative action. What would that action be? Now, there is one authority, one more slide. One authority, WHO, World Health Organization, way more respectful. 4th March 2015, Geneva Convention. A new WHO guideline recommends that adults and children reduce their daily intake of free sugars. Free sugars means, they did not say total or added, they say free sugars. Somebody that is sugary and does not have any other nutrition. So they include that sugar in your cereal, that sugar in your milk, that sugar in your juice. So they say that. To less than 10% of the total energy intake, they say that the total amount of sugar, fructose and glucose that you are consuming should be below the 200 calorie mark, not more than that. A further reduction to below 5% or roughly 25 grams per day would provide additional health benefits. But when did they recognize it? Reducing free sugars intake to less than 10% total energy intake was recommended by WHO study group for the first time in 1989. The food pyramid was introduced in 1989, 9 years after they knew what's going on. And it took them all those statistics and data to recommend this thing. From 1989 to 2015, they just allowed it to go out of hands. Who is responsible? Me? You recommended a food pyramid, I followed it, I got sick, and you knew that food pyramid is wrong. Who is responsible? I went to a doctor, I'm sick, he gave me the medication, I died. Who is responsible? I am responsible, or the doctor is responsible? They are saying, if you are dying from this food pyramid, you are responsible. Because you did not read out those small letter words, calories in, calories out, exercising and everything. This is where I wanted to come. I know whose fault is this. But now what can I do? I am not responsible. But I have to be aware. I have no choice. When you are fighting against a system, you need to be more aware. You need to be more organized. You need to be more zealous in your actions. Three steps. Learning. We learned something today? Mm-hmm. Doing. Exchange. Just three steps. Simple. We teach this to our kids every day. You need to share, you need to learn, you need to do this, you need to do that. We know this. How? Learning. Learn this. Right? I am no more eating a potato. I am eating a potato chips littered with chocolate. That's not food. It sounds like food. It's not food. My cereal is coming out of a factory. It is not food. If you are trying to feed me GMO, it is not food. If you are trying to feed me a bread which you have laden down HFCs and sugars in, it's not food. Because bread, according to me, what I learned was something that has flour and we can put some other things in it. We usually do that in India. We usually make a bread at home. We use whole wheat flour. We add onions. We add greens. We make bread on our own. We add sprouts. But I never saw my mom adding sugar to it. And trust me on this. The bread laden with sugar is bad. Is bad in taste. The bread laden without sugar was way good. Was way better. That can be my habit. But please make this your habit. We have options available. There are still people, she just mentioned Murillo. There are still some people who can make those things available. We are living in a fast life. We don't have time. I understand that. But we can still make choices. There is somebody who is still thinking sane. Thanks. I loved it.
Yeah.
I have an example to it. Sorry about that, Susan.
That's okay.
Yeah. Sorry about the example.
Oh, okay, go ahead.
Yeah.
I'm involved.
So I was just dealing with somebody who needed some help with her diet, and she's here, peanut butter. Kelly's friend, I forgot, whom I was talking to about peanut butter at Kelly's Nutrition. She was here for sure. Yeah, can you please come up? Yeah, you can stay there. So she was a user of PB2, right? Right. What PB2?
Powdered peanut butter.
What does it say? 98% less fat? Should be healthy? How much sugar does peanut have?
Zero.
How much sugar does PB2 have? Every serving? 1 teaspoon. What's healthy? That's food. PB2 is not. Remember this thing. When they are taking fat out of something that has fat naturally, they are trying to put in something that your body does not process in a way that it processes fat. And fat is not your enemy, my friend. It's not your enemy. You need it for your brain function. These were the right labels for the foods, actually. Right? This kid, little kid, has ADHD flakes, eh?
Yeah.
Right? And this pop never said obesity pop to me, although it is so. Right? And those pops which had no fat did not mention that they have no nutrition too. Zero nutrition pops. Right? And did you ever think that those hot dogs laden with like GMO fats and other stuff were producing colon cancer? But they never said so. So if tobacco companies should write down that tobacco does this to you, why food companies should do that?
Next, yeah.
Why should not they? We think a lot, like somebody added something to our water and we had that signed petition, remember? Here at Cali Tradition and everywhere. What about these people? Doing. Cut out all processing. Eat real. At least 80% of your diet should be real. Please eat your food. Please do not eat food like substances. Please eat your food. Right? Carbs are not bad. Don't take me wrong. But if you take them, that's the pyramid. Right? Mm-hmm. Leafy and colorful vegetables. 50% of the carbs that you get in your diet should come from these. Eat your beets, eat your broccolis, eat your beans, eat your celery, eat your anything that's sweet. Eat your cabbage, red cabbage, avocado, but should come from this. Second should be berries, nuts and seeds, fruits, berries, nuts and seeds, but fresh fruits. But you know, fresh fruits, are you kidding me? They say an apple travels about 26,000 miles before reaching the superstore. 26,000 miles. And then whole grains. And you remember that food pyramid 1980s? Whole grain was the base. So if you are eating your food in that manner, you are not putting a hormonal load in your body. You do not need to count your calories because your food doesn't come up with fat calories. Did you ever see an apple growing up with the nutritional facts written on it? Nature doesn't need that. Human bodies don't need that. Fats. Now when fats do not come up with a hormonal storm, when fats are not making my insulin angry, and now I know when eating certain kind of fats are going to make my heart feel better, my brain feel better, my Alzheimer's go away, my ADHD symptoms go away, why not? Seafood, nuts, seeds, fish, olives, eggs. There's no study in this world, no study till date in this world, which could prove that eating eggs or eating fish or eating meat made somebody die of a heart disease. There's no study. No study. Nobody could prove that with authority that this is what I have proved and this should be the thing. No.
But they say mercury. You got mercury in the fish.
Well, yeah, sure. Yep. Make your choices better. I'm not saying eat GMO olives. Canola oil was never produced by nature, right? Yeah, olives were. Right? Mm-hmm. Eat enough protein. Who eats like 1 gram of protein every day per kg body weight? None of you. Me too. Try doing that because protein is anti-aging. Step 3 is exchange. Why? Somebody asked me a good question. Why would you do that? Do you like to speak? I said my throat goes dry when I speak. I don't like to speak. No. But I feel that's my responsibility. Why? Because I don't want my son to be in that vicious cycle. I don't want my generations to come into that vicious cycle. I want to take a collaborative effort. This is what's happening to your social security, my friends, and Medicare deficits. This is where your cash is going. Everybody here, in India we have a different system. It's a private system. Government doesn't pay for my medical expenses. Your government is doing so. And it's coming out of your pocket. Somebody going obese, somebody eating out at McDonald's, landing in hospital, came out of all of us pockets. And by the year 2080, I don't know, but by the year 2025, Medicare is going to go broke. Medicare is going to go broke. And I will be 44 by that time. And some of you will be 60, 70, 80. Will we survive without it? So why not exchange this information? Why not tell your friend who tells you to eat normal food that you are eating normal food? Why to take that peer pressure? Chilling out at McDonald's is not chilling out. It's dying. It's making our generations suffer. Credit Suisse, everybody has heard the name? It's an investment bank. Anybody who has been in touch with some business ever in his life would know that investment banks love money, right? They never speak against any business, right? Here, Credit Suisse has a report. It says, in a 2000 study, sugar consumption at a crossroads, that was the name of the article, you can go home and search, found that close to 90% of the general practitioners surveyed in the US, Europe, and Asia believe excess sugar consumption is linked to the sharp growth in these health problems. And Health Canada says there is not enough evidence. The result is substantial costs for the economy and society, obesity and related health problems such as diabetes and a heightened risk of heart attack and stroke drive up healthcare costs and reduce worker productivity, ultimately making companies less competitive. They are talking sense. They are talking business, but they are talking sense. And authorities say there is not enough evidence. The number is 90%. These people have given their life, major part, to medical schools and medical practice. They are sane and they are not biased. And their business, their living depends on you being sick, but they still believe that sugar consumption is making things go worse, but authorities think they are not. There's not enough evidence. This is where I would end. If I'm not responsible for this, but I'm still being pulled into something that I don't want, I have to be resilient. I have to be aggressive. I have to shut down my ears. And I have to do whatever I think is right for me. I have to be aware. I have to know. I have to do. I have to share. I have to exchange. I have to make a collaborative effort. If we can have one health info group, if we can have 10 health info groups, if we can have 100 health info groups, and people come out of awareness of these menaces, these companies will not survive. They will change. We live in a democratic world. Some parts don't listen to it, but we still live in a democratic world. We can make them listen. But because they think that the consumer wants it, they feed it. We need to prove them wrong. To be yourself in a world that is constantly trying to make you something else is the greatest accomplishment. You tell me, no one can eat just one. I dare not to open your pouch of chips. I dare to tell you, I do not want to eat one. I don't want to know its taste. We need to rise as a society. We need to rise as a collaborative group of people, but effort starts individually. Do not look for short stages, short methods, short ways. There are no short ways. There's nothing in this world which will be a diet pill, magic diet, magic drink, magic lifestyle, magic exercise machine, magic gym, nothing. There will never be, because there is no machine like human body. If you know what human body does, feed it the way it wants you to. Thank you.